dealt with the subject matter of water pot revival out of John, the 4th chapter, verse number 25 through 30. You all who are familiar with the woman at the well and her water pot. So please, please, please join us in this revival. But before that, I want to introduce our guest speaker for this evening, and we'll be here until at least Thursday of this week. So his name is Alvin L. Daniels, Jr. He is a native of Florida, born and raised in the state of Florida. But Alvin Daniels is married and has been married for 27 years. He is married to a lovely wife by the name of Cynthia. Her maiden name was Cynthia Kendall. Now she is Cynthia Daniels. They have three children, very loving children who love to serve the Lord, just as Brother Alvin Daniels and his wife love to serve the Lord. He is the minister and evangelist at the Hope Church of Christ in Miami Garden, Florida.
Yes, sir.
And he's been preaching for about 20 years. Brother Daniels began his ministry journey by attending IBC, which is the International Bible College, with emphasis on doctrine and evangelism. I'll say that again, with emphasis on doctrine and evangelism. Brother Daniels also has a BA degree in sociology and anthropology. He has served in many a congregation in the southern region, either as a youth director, assistant minister, or an evangelist for the Church of Christ in the state of Georgia, the state of Tennessee, the state of Alabama, and the state of Mississippi. So without further ado, one of these fine preachers is going to come up, and our song leaders are going to lead us in a song. And if you don't mind, let us stand in the next song, or the next voice you hear after the song will be Brother Alvin L. Daniel, Jr. from the Hope Church of Christ.
You all will take this opportunity to walk for the song of invitation, number 642.
Yes, sir.
The invited hymn will be 642. Song with the glory of God, number 180. 180, all we're gonna have.
Like a lamp unto your feet, a light from Him I love. Around the land which sees no sun or moon, nor ever darkness dull, and radiant with the living spirit, who makes the
Oh,
out some praise tonight. On this week, and I appreciate all of the words of encouragement that I have received thus far. believe that it takes a people who are honest and transparent to respond appropriately and properly to a revival. Because it assumes that somebody has taken a look at themselves.
That's right.
An introspective look at themselves and determine that they can be better and that they can do better.
Yes. Amen.
And so for the next 4 days, I'm going to surrender to God and ask Him to use me so that I might be a blessing and a benefit to this church and all of those who come and convene together on this week. Amen. But I don't want you to see one sermon. I want you to see the totality of all that we share. Hopefully, trustfully, prayerfully, you'll come all week long.
Yeah. Come on,
Doug. You know, if this is your last night, y'all come back tomorrow. Y'all come all week long because I want you to see and to receive what I share comprehensively. Not just the one message, but the totality of all of the messages. Amen. And I'm going to be as humble as I can as I share God's word because I really want God to have His way. Amen.
Amen.
We hope, trust, pray that God will bless us in that regard. Second Kings, chapter number 6 on tonight. Rise to your feet if you could and would. Rise to your feet if you could and would. Second Kings, chapter number 6. I'm going to commence a reading at verse number 1. And I'm going to terminate at verse number 7 on tonight. Can y'all hear me okay? Can y'all hear me okay? Y'all need some more volume? Can somebody help me? Because I'll strain myself if I can't get a little bit more volume. I appreciate it very much. Amen. You feel more powerful when you have a good mic. Amplification. Amen. Amen. And I'm going to help strain and stress myself out. I appreciate it so very much. I don't know where y'all keep the DJ at, but it got to be around here somewhere. Amen. Amen. 2 Kings. Chapter number 6, we'll commence our reading at verse number 1, and we're going to terminate at verse number 7. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
And the reading say, bless the word.
Bless the word.
All right, and it reads just like this. I love that. Thank you. Thank you. What a blessing. What a blessing. What a blessing. And the sons of the prophet said to Elisha, behold, now the place where we dwell in thee is too straight, but too narrow for us.
Yes, sir.
He says, let us go, we pray thee, unto the Jordan, and take thence every man a beating, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he said, and answered, go ye.
Yes, sir.
And one said, be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to the Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was felling a beam, the axe head fell into the wall. And he cried and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, where fell it? And he showed him the place. And he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swing. Therefore, said he, take it up unto thee. And he put out his hands and took it up. Amen tonight?
Amen.
Pray with me tonight as I sermonize from the subject right out of verse number 6. Where did we lose? Where did we lose? Can you look at your neighbor? Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Where did we lose?
Where did we lose?
Look at your other neighbor, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I plan to find
it. I plan to find
it. We see it in the presence of the Lord. Where did we lose? Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I just thought it was proper for us to commence our revival, at least this weekly revival, by talking about leadership and vision. It is my belief, it is my sentiment that real revival in the church begins with the leadership in the church. Because we cannot truly have revival among the membership and among the flock until we have had a revival among the leadership. Because as goes the leadership, so goes the fellowship. The fellowship would never surpass the leadership.
Yes, sir.
Because the followers cannot go where the leaders will not go. And the followers cannot know what the leaders do not know. So in order for us to experience a real, true revival in the church, there must be a revival among the leadership. When we talk about leadership in the church, God has always stirred the hearts of the leaders before he would stir the hearts of the people. Now remember in the Old Testament canon that God stirred up the heart of Zerubbabel, and then Zerubbabel stirred up the heart of Joshua, and then Joshua stirred up the hearts of the people. And so that is to say that true revival in the body of Christ cannot commence until there is a revival among the leaders. Can the church say amen? And when I say leadership, I'm talking about those who are out front and center. Those who have the best interests of the church at heart. Those who have a passion for doing God's will. Those who have a passion for committing to God's will, and those who have a passion for leading God's people. We cannot have a progressive church with a regressive leadership. The church will never be able to forge forth and be all that God has called it to be until the leaders are up front and center and they have undergone their own personal revival. So tonight, if you would with me, let's look at a 7th century text and see if we can come out with a 21st century application. I got license for this. The Apostle Paul says, whatsoever things that were written before time were written for our learning, that we from patience and comfort of the scriptures we might have hope. I believe sometimes it's necessary to go back in order to go forward. Because sometimes when you go back, you are able to muster the strength and the courage to forge forward. Amen. Because what God has done in the past, he'll also do right now. But you need to know that you're not alone in this race called life. Amen, somebody. That there were others in the self-same condition, in the self-same position that you are in. And if God has done great things for others, God will do great things for us. Can the church say amen right here? Amen, amen. So our text tonight involves a 7th century prophet by the name of Elisha. You and I know, if you have read your Bible, that Elisha is the mentor, the mentee of Elijah. He is the successor of the school of the prophets. His hands were laid on him in 1 Kings by Elijah. Now Elijah is the iconic prophet of the Old Testament. Amen, somebody. And he is a phenomenal prophet. And God had used him to do some phenomenal things. Amen, somebody. But our text begins tonight with Elisha having taken the reins from Elijah. And one thing that is very curious about this prophet Elisha is that in chapter number 2 of 2 Kings, he knew, because God had given him, Brother Anderson, a clear indication that God was going to take Elijah away.
Yeah.
And so before he would take Elijah away, which was his mentor, he asked Elijah for a double portion of the Spirit.
Yeah, sure.
And I scratched my head and I asked myself, why in the world would one preacher ask another preacher for a double portion? And I thought about that thing. I said, why would one preacher want to have double power or more power than the previous preacher?
Come on, God.
And I said to myself, is he just selfish?
Hey.
Is he a preacher that just want to be better than any other preacher? Is he a preacher that's trying to rank himself among preachers? But as I read the text, my conclusion was he didn't decide that he wanted to be a better preacher than Elijah, because after all, they serve the same God. My understanding is that he looked at the scope of what he had to do as a minister, and he looked at the ministry of Elijah, and he looked at the work that God had planned for him to do, and he realized and he recognized that he needed more power in his ministry than Elijah needed. He wasn't trying to be better. He just had a different kind of ministry. Because God had showed him the scope and the depth of his ministry, and he knew that he needed a special portion of the Spirit in order to do what God has called him to do. Can I stop right here and say something? Us preachers, we ought not be in competition. I pray for that. Y'all go help me out. We ought not be in competition with one another. We just have different assignments. And there is nothing wrong with me praying to God, asking God for more of his power, more of his Spirit, because I'm going to be serving a different generation. Elijah realized that he was a part of a brand new era. And because he was a part of a brand new era, he needed more power than Elijah had in his era. I'm going to say a little tonight. We are living in a different kind of time. You cannot afford to be the preacher that we were on yesterday, because the church and the complexion of the church has changed. And when the church has changed, we need maximum power to minister to a brand new generation. And when Elijah asked for a double portion of the Spirit, he knew that he had to serve a different era and a different generation with different kinds of issues. Amen, somebody. But you know, God gave him that double portion of the Spirit. And because he gave him that double portion of the Spirit, the school of the prophets grew exponentially. And that's what happens when you have the Spirit of God. When you got the Spirit of God, you can't do nothing but grow. When you have the Spirit of God, you can't do nothing but advance. I don't know, I wish I had a truth right there. But when you have the Spirit of God, things are going to change. Amen, somebody. Paul said, I called granted Apollos water, but God gave the increase. I help you know tonight that our God is a God of increase. I said a God of increase, not a God of decrease. When we are decreasing, it is a sign that God may not be present. Y'all don't help them go preaching in here. Our God is a God of increase. And whenever God is among his people, there's going to be some telltale sign, because the church is going to grow. And God has always wanted his church to grow. God don't want us to be satisfied with the status quo, because our God is a God of increase. Amen, somebody. And so when the text opens up, chapter number 6 and verse number 1, the text opens up with a crisis.
Come on, God.
Brother Wallace, they have a crisis at the entrance of chapter number 6 and verse number 1. The first crisis that they have is a crisis of capacity. Somebody say capacity. Everybody didn't say that. Y'all ain't working with me now. Don't make me come on the floor tonight. Somebody say capacity. It is because the school of the prophets were growing. Because of God's spirit being among God's people, that the school of the prophets expanded. It grew exponentially. Amen, somebody. And so the complexion of the school of the prophets had changed, and therefore their surroundings needed also to change. Because the text opens up that one prophet says, "Behold now, Elijah, the place where we dwell with thee is too straight, too narrow, too small, too limited for us." That's the crisis, because we cannot long stay in this self-same situation. There was a crisis of capacity. They said that we don't want to maintain the status quo. Amen, somebody. Because if God is amongst us, we don't have to grow as we go with God. So the text opens up with somebody saying, somebody that had some vision, they said, the place where we dwell with thee is too narrow for us. Y'all don't hear it in the spirit tonight. They said, in our 21st century application, they said, the place that we are in right now is going to require much more capacity. The place where we are right now is not big enough for us. The place that we are right now don't have enough power enough for us. The place where we are right now is too limited, too narrow, too short for us right now. Amen, somebody. They said, we need more capacity and we need more power. And when it comes to revival in the body of Christ, somebody had to realize and understand and know that we need more capacity. Because the church today is not the same church of yesterday. I wish I had a church. The church has more problems now than the church had back then. As a matter of fact, the members of the church are different now than they were back then. We got some family problems now that we've not had in the past. We got some children right now that we've not had in the past. We have some dynamics in the church now that we've not had in the past. Amen, somebody. We got some situation that we're dealing with in our communities now that we've not had in the past. And we are not just ministering to those who are members of the church. We have to realize that we have to minister to those who are on the outside of the church. Amen, somebody. And you and I know that our communities are now of the change. That our families now are now of the change. Our young men and our young ladies are now of the change. I'm from Miami. That's how I'm talking about. Amen, somebody. We're dealing with a brand new world. Amen, somebody. And the church cannot maintain the status quo. We have to be bigger. We have to have more capacity. We have to have more power than we have ever.